Problem with these slides. Dr. Krishnamraju sir will start the session within 1 minute. Thank you.
When I go on to the next presentation, I need somebody to help.
Yes.
This is good. The participants, how do they see from here or from there?
Never
asked.
Yes.
From there. So if I stand, I block it, then they will not be able to see.
No, only if I have the slides are
okay. Only slides are seen by them.
Yes. I mean, now if you want to talk directly.
So when I speak from here, they'll be able to hear better. Should we try this?
I see that website.
You may not be able to see me, but can you hear my voice? It's okay.
Yeah, yeah.
Hey, if you want to keep it for you. They can see?
Yes, sir, they can see.
Okay. So, good evening to everybody. Thanks for joining us. Next, probably 2.5 hours or 3 even, I don't want to scare you, are going to be a presentation of multimodality cardiac imaging, which will include, no, it will exclude echo, but will include CT, MRI, PET, etc. But some of them may have few echo images. And basically, these are all case-based studies.
Recording in progress.
And I would like to tell you something which actually is quite important in the sense that, one, what I am going to show, many of these case examples, the examples of cardiac pathology are extremely rare, very rare. Don't be disappointed, because when I asked one of my BM students to examine a particular patient and told him that this is a very, very rare case, and this is the only second time I'm seeing in my 50-year career, you may never see in your career, so you better see it now. I got an electric answer back, nuclear answer back. Said, if I'm not going to see it, why see it now? There are two ways of looking at it. One is, if I am not going to see, why bother about it? The other way of saying it is, oh, this is a great opportunity for me to see a rare case and learn from it. Right? I don't know which category you will fall, but I was always excited by some cases which are very, very rare. Some of them we did publish. I'll show you some of them. And that stimulates your curiosity, questioning, your mental capabilities, and then it makes you dig through the available literature and then show to everybody. And it does impress the patient and family quite frequently. You know, they get you more patients because you made a rare diagnosis, in case the patient doesn't die. So that is one of the aspects of these cases. Second thing I want to emphasize is most of them, probably more than 85% of them, you will not be able to make a diagnosis. Though I am going to ask you, but you will not be able to make a diagnosis. But don't be disappointed. Don't be depressed. There is nothing to do directly with your exam. In the examination, the relatively common, relatively much easier images will be shown. These are very difficult. And I must tell you, these are patient examples which were never made out by any cardiologist most of the time, till the last goal post where we made the diagnosis, including me. I also missed many of them, more than 85%. It is not easy, right? But when you make the diagnosis finally, it gives you a big thrill. Because it's a new knowledge you have been, you have read through it. So, why I'm telling you all that is, at the end of the presentation, you might think you could make even now a good diagnosis of many of them, so you may get depressed. So don't. Don't at all. The best of the cardiologists also did not make the proper diagnosis till the very last evaluation, which could have been histopathology or surgery or something like autopsy, etc. So don't be disappointed, okay? It's not moving. Want me to move here? So in cardiology, image is everything, right? So cardiovascular imaging is extremely important, and it is the core of cardiology. No matter what you do, whether you do interventional work, do a intervention for structural disease or coronary, or EP or pediatric or whatever, but image is central. Image could be an echo or CT or MRI or PET, but it is central. So you can never be a good cardiologist without being a good cardiac imagologist. At least a reasonable amount of knowledge is absolutely essential. The reason being, if you leave these things to radiologists, they are working under the difficult circumstances because they don't have the clinical background of the patient. Their knowledge of cardiac anatomy, cardiac physiology, cardiac pathology, and then the surgical anatomy of some of the surgical procedures that were done, like, for example, Fronton, bidirectional Glenn, etc. They don't know what they are. So it is very, very tough for the radiologist. So nobody knows heart better than a cardiologist. So you are the one who should be educating images for your own sake. Right? So that, I think, is the most important statement I just made. That is a summary of my next 2 hour I want to go to.
Echo texture and all. You hypoaspirin. Is it size?
मैंने चूसा नंबर तो फाइव रेडी हो चुका है पक्का जी मैं लेटेस्ट पिक्चर
नंबर क्या बात है
तो चार बार जैसे सॉरी ये जैसी पिक्चर है ना
हाँ हाँ ये वन टेंडर 5 centimeter कंडे को हमारे पास ना पंसल लगा 44 centimeter
जो ये मैं कोल ना हाँ
तो अभी पेरू तो उनको भी बट फाइबर है ना कॉमन
कॉमन क्या पर है ना
एंड
This is being disturbed by people who are talking. Can you please mute your mic? Okay.
They can only listen. They cannot talk.
Thank you. So these are all the various imaging techniques which all of you are familiar. I don't want to go into this. Echo Doppler, you do it every day. CT has gained a big importance now. Contrast angio we have been doing for more than 50-60 years or even more than that. DSA we were doing frequently but not so much now. Then angioscopy is practically out now with OCT, etc. Now the OCT is not included in this. OCT is going to be non-invasive like the ophthalmologist. Now we are doing an invasive OCT. But the work is on to do a non-invasive transthoracic OCT like the ophthalmologist too. And that comes, it will be even a better thing. Then you have PET imaging, then you have MRI. MRI has taken over a lot of things in cardiology. Chest X-ray, of course, the classical. Now, there is a fusion imaging now. You are mixing different imaging techniques. So it could be PET CT, that we already have been doing it. Then PET MRI is superior to PET CT. There is no PET MRI in India except one in Delhi, one in Mumbai. PET MRI is much more useful than PET CT, right? And then you also have SPECT echo. Echo is mixed with the nuclear, right? Now you have hybrid labs. In hybrid labs, you have lot of these imaging techniques along with cath lab, right? And next door will be operation theater. So it has become a hybrid suit where you can image, do any imaging you want, and then you can do an intervention. And if the patient has to go for a surgery emergency, there's an operation theater close by, or you can do a hybrid procedure. Part of it is done by the surgeon, part of it is done by you. Okay, so those things are developing very fast. Now, PET itself has gone into a digital mode now. What we have in India is analog PET. But digital PET is the in thing now, which we don't have in India. So per square inch, it has 20,000 more pixels, right? So the image is so much better. So actually it is so useful in malignancies. It can pick up even 1 millimeter of the malignant or tumor anywhere in the body, the digital one. But for the one which we are doing analog, it requires 2 to 3 millimeters at least. And digital is faster, at least half the time of what we are doing now. Transmission is better across the world. So there are many, many advantages. But it is very expensive. Its radiation levels are also lower. Current one which we are using is approximately 18 to 20 millisieverts. Digital one will be something like 10 or so. Okay, a lot of advantage. MRI also has moved on. So MRI disadvantage was it is very nice. There is claustrophobia. Now the silent MRIs have come. There is one in Delhi, one in Mumbai. And they are absolutely silent. They don't make any sound at all. Okay. Then second disadvantage with MRI is it takes longer time, 40 minutes, 1 hour. Now they have brought it down to with 3 Tesla. Now the 25 Tesla is available in the laboratory. In the market, we have up to 5 Tesla. So the scan time also has come down from 40 minutes to something roughly 15 minutes or so. Okay. Now another disadvantage of MRI was it is a big machine. Can't be moved. unlike echo machine, it can't be moved anywhere. Patient has to be moved in. Sometimes a critical patient is on so many apparatus like ventilator, I mean IAVP, etc., etc. They may or may not be compatible with the magnetic field. There are issues. All right. But now in San Diego, they have introduced a mobile MRI. Mobile MRI, it can be wheeled into ICCU, to the bedside of the patient. Its magnetic field is not that powerful as to be of a problem with metallic organs. So that has been demonstrated. Now they are using it on an experimental basis in California in 2 or 3 labs. The originator is from La Jolla near San Diego. Okay, that's a beautiful place. That is where Eric Topol is currently working his research. So we have moved on from our previous generation equipment to new generation equipment. So we'll be doing LARC now. This is an extremely important statement. No test is perfect. Don't depend at all on one test. All of them are complementary to each other. That is the reason why, and they're expensive, mind you. Equipment is expensive, maintenance is expensive, personnel are expensive, for the patient, cost is expensive. So you need to choose which test is appropriate for a given patient. Right? For that, you have good physical examination, good fundamentals like ECG, X-ray, echo, etc. You must have a clinical question. So what are the clinical questions to be answered? Depending on those clinical questions, you will choose the imaging technology. That is the targeted technology which you need to use. Just because your hospital has everything, you are not going to use all of them. That is not appropriate, that will not be paid in a country like US, right? So it's going to be like that here also because of the insurance. So these are all the various things we talked about. Now multimodality, now these days, every patient is going into multimodality imaging. We are not happy with only one imaging technique. You might do an X-ray, then do an echo, move on to a CT or MRI or a PET in under certain specific circumstances. So multimodality cardiac imaging for detecting the cardiac pathological diagnosis is the standard of care now. The only thing is we need to know which investigation gives you the answer. You can't be doing all of them, right? So primary modalities, we know ultrasound, CT, MR, and angio, and functional and molecular imaging could be a PET or SPECT or PET-CT combined. That is all fusion imaging. It's also called as a fusion imaging. When we say multimodality cardiac imaging, it is not necessarily fusion imaging. It can be serial multimodality, one after another. But when we say fusion imaging, there is a live, you are doing a CT and PET. They are integrated live, right? In real time. PET MRI also in real time. Now what PET CT we are doing is not really fusion imaging, because they are acquired separately, then they are combined. The current the new technology which is already available is, they are acquired simultaneously and electronically fused already. That we are not doing as yet. This is ultrasound, you know, echocardiography, what all it can do. Something which is unique to echocardiography is, it is mobile. It can be done anywhere. Wherever power is available, you can do it. That is its major advantage. Second is, it gives you reasonably accurate hemodynamic data, which CT cannot give you. MRI can give to some extent, but not as good as echo. But CT doesn't give you hemodynamics. Evidence it might give, but not direct. CAT does give you invasive catheterization, does give you direct data. Okay, so Doppler echocardiography, strain rate imaging, velocity imaging, etc., that group of things will give you a hemodynamic data. It is a hemodynamic echocardiography. It is something like a cardiac CAT, non-invasive cardiac CAT. That is its advantage. Now, cardiac computed tomography can give you good anatomy and morphology. It will tell you about function, wall motion. It can tell you about perfusion. One major advantage is you can look at the coronaries. Coronaries, as you can see. Also, you can look at the plaque and the plaque bundle, calcium and calcium bundle. Magnetic resonance imaging, the disadvantage when compared to CT is we are not yet good at getting the coronaries. We can get the segments of the coronaries, but not the total coronaries. So there is an issue there. But someday it is going to come. Someday. When it does come, then MRI will leap beyond CT. But as of now, CT has advantage as long as far as coronary anatomy is concerned. But all other purpose, anatomy, physiology, function, wall motion, myocardial scarring, scar burden, right? Then all that, even plaque burden, MRI is very good. It's forced over the CT. So this is where MRI. So it can give you a very advanced technique of detection of ischemia. And if you have a patient with heart failure, you don't know why. So you can look at the myocardium for the scarring, sarcoidosis, tuberculosis, granulomatous, myocarditis, etc., etc. And then pre and post EP procedures, follow-up of these patients, and cardiac function, regional and global, and congenital heart disease. There is a great advantage of MRI. Congenital heart disease, particularly where, it is difficult to catch, difficult to angio, and you can't get into pulmonary arteries, right? You can't get into collaterals, etc. So some of these areas, your MRI is extremely, extremely useful in congenital heart disease, and there is no radiation. It doesn't harm the baby, unlike CT. It also is good in congenital heart disease, but then there is contrast. It can produce problems, heart failure, etc., and then cal radiation. So there is a future risk of a malignancy, etc. But MR scores over that. So these are the combination. Now you have PET CT, you have echo CT, you have echo SPECT, you have PET MRI. PET MRI is not shown here, but the slide was done a few years back. Now you have PET MRI. But unless you have a clinical question, you can't blindly ask for all the investigations. I still remember when I was practicing in Medinova in late 80s and early 90s, there was a patient who was referred by a physician from Karnool. What he asked for was, I asked for upper GI endoscopy, colonoscopy, laparoscopy, cystoscopy, what else? He wanted all scopes. He didn't know what he was looking for. Otherwise, he will become blind. So the fundamental thing is, what is your clinical question, to be honest? To get the clinical question, you need to have a good knowledge of patient's, problem, history, and also physical examination and reasonable interpretation of other non-invasive data. Then you have questions. Unless you have questions, you are not looking for answers. Unless you are looking for a specific answer, you can't choose your imaging technique. Now we'll move on to case examples. Okay, that was the introduction. I hope you are inspired to look at the cases. That was a reasonably good introduction. It's okay. I don't mean you. I will give you a two-line history of these patients. Actually, they have a long history.
Is it okay? You have the turn up the lights or is it okay?
I think you can turn up this if you can.
Yeah.
Selectively. Back of the hall lights can be on. Only this.
Right.
Perfect. Thank you. I'm going to give you only two line or three line history, though I have the entire history, because time would not permit me to show you more cases. A young girl of about 17, 18 years, complained of cough, a little bit of hemorrhage disease, shortness of breath for a few months before she presented to us. She was already seen in Guntur, a couple of medical college hospitals. She's from Tenali, and she was done some preliminary investigations. Nobody gave any exact diagnosis. At that point in time, she came to us. Okay. So, this is not my patient, my colleague's patient came to me for a second opinion. These days, Daya Sagar and me, people like, we always get only second opinion, third opinion cases.
Okay.
Almost never the first opinion. So when we did the echo of this patient, has shown that the pulmonary artery pressure is high. There was a pulmonary artery hypertension. So there was a suspicion that there may be a pulmonary thromboembolism. So there was hemoptysis, shortness of breath, only 2 months. Okay. Then we went on to the CT. This is CT. Okay. Now the CT has shown. I hope you can see the pointer. Look at this. This is the main pulmonary artery, which is dilated. Normally, main pulmonary artery is the same size as the aorta. You can see that it is bigger than aorta. This is aorta. Okay. This is the left pulmonary artery. This is the right pulmonary artery. So there is a mass here. Right pulmonary artery is completely occluded. So, the treating cardiologist in my hospital is a classical pulmonary thromboembolism, pulmonary arterial hypertension. Then he actually did an angio. It's not running, it was there in the other file. But anyway, it basically shows the same. Basically, it shows the same. Then they tried to cross the lesion and stent it, but they couldn't do it. Right? And then she started developing some problems, so they abandoned the procedure. Then, after that, the girl was sent to me for evaluation. I also did not know any diagnosis at this point in time, except thinking that there is some occlusive mass in the right pulmonary artery, which is producing a pulmonary arterial hypertension. Okay, but when I looked at the previous images, what struck me was this mass is going beyond the right pulmonary artery. It is not confined to the lumen of the right pulmonary artery. It is going beyond the lumen of the right pulmonary artery. As you can see here, right, it is going beyond the pulmonary artery. So I was not comfortable with the diagnosis of pulmonary thromboembolism. There is no reason for the thrombus to go beyond the outside pulmonary artery, right? And then there were also lymph nodes on the CT, mediastinal lymph nodes. So I was thinking that this is not thrombus. This must be some malignancy. Then I went on to do.
There is one more marker. You see the tapering of that pulmonary artery. Usually you don't get that kind of tapering with the thrombus. There is a blood cutoff, especially in acute wounds. But here you see the tapering, gradual tapering that, of that high pulmonary artery.
How you differentiate is one, thrombus is confined to the lumen,
yeah.
Whereas malignancy goes into the wall of the artery and beyond the wall of the artery. That is second feature. Third is lymph nodes. There is no reason why a thromboembolic thing should have lymph nodes unless there is a different pathology also. Okay. Now the clinching thing is, if you do an MRI, or if you do even better, if you do a PET CT, right? Thrombus does not take up gadolinium. Thrombus does not take up FDG. That clinches the diagnosis. That did clinch the diagnosis in this patient. Look here. This is FDG IV. Can you see? So it is heart. It is FDG heart. So then immediately we knew this is not thrombus. This has to be, either it could be infection or inflammation or malignancy. It is not benign, it is not thrombus. Okay, then we have to prove. So we tried to do a transpulmonary artery biopsy. Transpulmonary artery biopsy. But she crashed on the table and died. So this is a PA sarcoma. RPA, right pulmonary artery is a sarcoma. Now the message here, each one of the case I show you as a message. The message here is, whenever you find something like that, where your diagnosis is a mass in the pulmonary artery, commonest being thrombus, of course, don't confine yourself to thinking this is thrombus. It could be something else as well. It can be a tumor embolism, or it can be a tumor in situ, or it can be a tumor growing from lung or mediastinum into the pulmonary artery. Right? Keep that always in mind. They are rare. Right? But you have to keep that. It's not all that rare. You do see them once in a while. Okay? So this was the sarcoma of the pulmonary artery. This is something we saw only 1.5 years back. This has even a longer story. This is about roughly 42, 43 years. A young male from Vijayawada. He is a computer guy, technology man. He was working for a hospital software department, electronics department. He just had, for insurance, he got a checkup done. Then they found first degree AV block. It was totally asymptomatic. First degree AV block, PR interval was 0.28 or something like that. Then he went to the cardiologist there. The cardiologist sent him to the echo lab. Echo lab reported normal. Right? So they were concerned about the AV block. They thought there may be some inflammatory myocarditis, so they did an MRI.
Recording stopped.
Okay. Now when they did an MRI, they found that there is a mass on the mitral valve, which is taking up gadolinium. So they were nonplussed. There is big mass, gadolinium uptake, but echo report says normal. Right? So at the same sitting, they also did an EP. They found that there is a infrahesian block, atrioventricular block. Suprahesian atrioventricular block. Then they went down to the echo lab and caught hold of that echo guy and told him that there is a mass on the mitral valve on MRI. You have written that it is normal. It's just less than 24 hours. So he again did it and that there was a mass, which he missed obviously. There was a big mass. And there was mitral regurgitation. There were 3+ mitral regurgitation, 3 out of 4+. So he was advised to have a mitral valve replacement. At that point in time, he contacted somebody, that somebody knew one cardiologist in Hyderabad. So he sent him to his friend cardiologist in Hyderabad. So he did echo here. He made some diagnosis. Then he was one of my students. So he sent the patient to me. So I was the third stop. So I made some diagnosis. I sent to my echo lab. My echo two people saw and they made a fifth diagnosis. Then it went to EP people. EP people made a sixth diagnosis. Total 9 cardiologists have seen this patient. Nobody was right at the end. In Vijayawada, it was normal. Then it became mass and mitral valve. He made a diagnosis of fibroblastoma of the mitral valve. It was completely wrong because it is an uptake of the gadolinium. Fibroblastoma never takes some gadolinium. He described that. Findings were right. The diagnosis was wrong. He was a radiologist. His fellowship in cardiac imaging from Europe. So much for that. Okay. Then he came here. He was advised the MBR. Then the Hyderabad first cardiologist made a diagnosis of myxoma of the mitral valve. Then I made a diagnosis of fibrosarcoma of the mitral valve. Gadolinium enhancement has to be managed. My two cardiology colleagues, one made a diagnosis of lipoma, another made some other diagnosis. Then the EP people made a diagnosis of liposarcoma. Right? At that point in time, so I went and investigated. Here you can see, this was published last August, you know, American Echocardiography Journal. This case report was published. So this is the ECG you can see. This is the echo. Actually, videos are there. This is the mass on the anterior mitral leaflet. T was done. This is the mass. This is the three-dimensional echo. Can you see that? So this is a surgical view of the mitral valve or three-dimensional echo. The arrow shows the mass. Okay. Then this is the MRI. You can see the MRI gadolinium uptake here. This is the mass. This is the mass. This is the mass. And also, there is some gadolinium uptake in the ventricular septum. Can you see that? Ventricular septum, this is on the valve. All right. Then I send this patient for PET. You can see the PET imaging. This is the mass, PET CT. So there is an intense uptake of the FDG. The SUV max, SUV is a parameter which is it. What it means is standard uptake value, SUV max, maximum. Maximum uptake was 28 in this patient. This is urinary bladder. Luckily for him and luckily for us, he had an external iliac lymph node. This is one of the major advantages of PET CT. Because to go and do a biopsy of the left heart from the mitral valve is extremely, extremely difficult. All right? I mean, not open heart, but through a catheter, biopsy catheter. So here we found, luckily, an external iliac large lymph node with an SUV max of about 26. This was 26. All right. Then we pulled out this lymph node. This is the histopathology, which had shown a granulomatous change. Granulomatous change with some small areas of necrosis. Not too many areas. Small areas of necrosis, you can see. Right? So then we got a quantiferon gold, which was strong positive. Quantiferon gold was strong positive. So then we made a diagnosis of tuberculosis. Most probably dominant tuberculosis. But AFB were not demonstrated in the biopsy. So we made a diagnosis of cardiac tuberculosis and tuberculoma of the mitral. Tuberculoma of the mitral valve, myocardial tuberculosis, and systemic lymph nodal involvement. And because it is at the mitral valve, it has produced the first degree. All right. And then the bigger complication than our diagnosis was this guy's brother-in-law is a cardiologist to me, you see. They can be pain in the ass. It's a big problem. This guy, every day will ring them up. They say something. Then he disappears for 2-3 months. We call him, he doesn't take the call, he doesn't reply to our messages. That was the story. But anyway, finally, he was convinced, and then he was put on antitubercular therapy. After 2 weeks, we put him on steroids, and everything cleared. But we don't have post-treatment here. In the paper we published, this is the post-treatment. The lower one. Compare this with this. This is pre-treatment, this is post-treatment, PET-CT. Alright? So, complete clearance. Now it is 1.5 years. He was here about 10 months back. He was doing fine. And we published this thing. So, the message here is, rare cases do occur. Unless you have them at the back of your mind, you will never think of them. If you don't think of them, you will never investigate them. So what is the great thing we have done in this patient? We gave him a disease diagnosis, final diagnosis. 2, he escaped mitral valve replacement. He escaped a prosthetic valve. He escaped anticoagulation and long-term problems. Alright? And he is cured. You can't say that about many patients in cardiology. Patient?
MR
disappeared, sorry. I forgot to tell you. MR disappeared. 3 plus MR had become trivial. That area was something like 7 centimeters square before. After the 1 year treatment, actually by the 4th month we repeated that. This was the 4th month. At that time, the jet area of the mitral regurgitation was 0.3 inch. Totally disappeared. Almost. Disappeared. Because the tumor was on the valve which is not allowing it to close properly. Mechanical cooperation. Once the tumor disappeared, tuberculoma disappeared, then it was able to close approximate valve. So, this is a tuberculoma of the mitral valve with tubercular myocarditis. All right? So, this is a CT. The diagnosis is already written there. Occluded lima. So, CT is very, very useful, particularly in post-CABG patients where you are evaluating. This is excellent for the graft assessment. Excellent. And if you are going to do an invasive angiography also, it saves you a lot of contrast, saves you a lot of time. You know that this graft is closed. There is no point in trying to probe for it. Because you go on injecting, you take a lot of fluorotype, patient is on table for hours together sometimes. This is what we experience pre-CT. But now we know which graft is to be angioed, which graft is not accessible and not there at all. So this is an MRI of a patient. Look at this scar. Can you see that? So there is no investigation. It can show you the myocardial scarring as good as an MRI.
Scar,
yeah. That is a scar. This is also scar. You can see here, this is all scar. It can also give you scar border.
Big. What a marker on your
Other people will not be able to see. People who are on the long day. So this is a scar. Okay. Another view, this is the scar. Now the it will tell you whether there is a scar or no scar. It will tell you where is the scar. And depending on the location of the scar, sometimes we can make a very brilliant diagnosis. I'll show you some examples. And then it will also tell you the current technology has the capability to tell you the scar burden. What is the total LV mass in this particular patient? How much of it is scar that it can give you now? Right? So we are able to give the 5%, 10%, 15%, 20%, 30%, so on and so forth. Ultimately, the patient symptoms, complications, longevity, prognostication, or arrhythmias, a sudden cardiac death, many of them are related to presence or absence of scar and then quantification of the scar. That is the reason why scar is very, very important. The location of the scar can tell you whether it is an ischemic scar or myocarditis scar or is it a sarcoid scar or is it Fabry scar, etc. All right? Convinced or not convinced?
Yeah.
It's good.
Based on the thing, what do you think is the probability cause here?
It's
a venue. So, can this be cardiac still?
No, sir. It's cardiac myopathy restricted to one.
No, not 20% of the cardiac myopathy.
Right, sir.
We have scar in the subarachnoid artery.
Basically, the location of the scar, the earliest part of myocardium becomes ischemic in 7 degrees. Right? Another advantage is your angiogram may be normal, but still they may have ischemic scars. So micro circulation ischemia can also be detected on the MRI. That is another advantage which is found out in the last decade or so. This is one of the methods which can tell you about microcirculatory problem of the coronary circulation. So this is a coronary artery disease with late gadolinium enhancement. This is one of the common applications of MRI in our practice because CAD is one of the commonest diseases. This is another exciting thing. Any one of you make a diagnosis? It's very classical. It's a rupture. Yes. This is a rupture.
Right? The
contrast is leaking into the pericardium. This is color. This is our, I mean, machine color. All right? This is the thing. This patient came with, if I remember right, LCH territory infarct. Then he had a persistent chest pain. He was in shock. Echo was done. Echo was done repeatedly, but they did not find anything unusual. So they didn't know why he has continued this thing. So at that point in time, we decided to do this investigation. Then we found that this is the rupture. So immediately, we rushed him into the theater. Our surgeon found not a big rupture, but pinhead-sized rupture, which he closed it and then gave some grafts. Patient was discharged fine. So this can also be helpful situations where you are unable to make up your mind on echo. The clue on echo is presence of pericardial fluid. Acute MI, continuing chest pain, or new chest pain that has come, particularly on day 3, day 4, etc. Okay. And if you find fluid on echo, first diagnosis on the top of this has got to be rupture.
Can you probably differentiate a rupture and a sore and a rupture?
There are many differences that are given.
One of them is that. The color doctor, if you see the color doctor, then you'll be able to visualize the flow and get sore and
no, flow can be there even in that.
But the mouth, neck of the opening, and
one is broad, the other one is
narrow.
So this is also a rare case. A 45-year-old man, MRI was done. The background is he came with shortness of breath, class 3. On echocardiography, ejection fraction was not too low, something like 40 to 45, mid-range HF, mid-range EF, HF, mid-range EF. Right, and we had echocardiogram done, and that was the EF. Then we did a MRI. What is significant here is, now look at the scar. Okay, this is the anterobasal scar of the septum. This location is very typical for sarcoid. Not that it doesn't occur in others, but when it is present, sarcoid need to be number one differential diagnosis. This indeed was sarcoid. There were also lymph nodes, the mediastinal lymph nodes. So transbronchial lymph node biopsy was done. Sarcoid was proven and also treated with corticosteroids and methotrexate. So look at the why this is shown to you is you have seen the ischemic scar. Now this is the sarcoid scar. So anterobasal ventricular septal scar immediately should flash in mind, maybe this is sarcoid. Clearly there are lymph nodes in the mediastinum. All right?
But one of the reasons why conduction disturbances are also not
abnormal. Yeah, they're quite common. First degree, second degree, even complete. And they also have ventricular tachycardia, arrhythmia, selectical storm, sudden death. All of them can happen. A good thing about sarcoid is those complications are not there. It is totally reversed. It's totally reversed. But when we were students, it was thought sarcoid does not exist in India.
But for quite some time, we never diagnosed
sarcoid. Never diagnosed. None of these things were there. It was never diagnosed. Probably, these were treated as tuberculosis. So, in our student days also, there were only two diseases in medicine, general medicine. One was tuberculosis. The other was amoebiasis.
And even before that, there were another disease, syphilis.
Huh?
Syphilis was another one.
That was, just before our MBBS days.
Yeah, and 40s.
Right? Okay, are you impressed with this scar?
Yes.
Then we'll move on. Is the cardiac sarcoidosis proven and treated? Now, what do you find here? Is also an MRI. This patient is about 30 plus. He came from Singareni College, he's an employee there. He had a cardiac arrest. I gave you a clue already. Loud, I can't hear. Huh?
Yeah.
Yeah, it is. It is arrhythmogenic, right ventricular.
On what basis you said?
But you need to know. Now, what is the reason? You need to know why.
No, the reasons. Why you are saying they are.
Suppose we gave the right diagnosis without knowing why we gave the diagnosis, you are buried. No, look at the right ventricle. Look at this.
So
this is right ventricle. Right ventricle is dilated, okay? This is right ventricular free wall, which is thinned out, and there is fat, fibrofatty tissue, which is very clear. And then if you see closely, there are some pouch-like things here, for example, there is another here. Pouch-like things are, they may also be called as small aneurysms, multiple pouches or multiple aneurysms. This indeed was ARVC, arrhythmogenic right ventricular cardiomyopathy. Now, though it is called ARVC, now it has been, it is known that if they live long enough, they may develop left ventricle. So biventricular arrhythmogenic cardiomyopathy. Okay, if this fellow does not die and goes into 40s and 50s, may develop biventricular. Third variety is right ventricle is normal, isolated LV cardiomyopathy, arrhythmogenic cardiomyopathy. Isolated. RV is normal. That is rare. This is common. Next is biventricular. Last and least common is isolated LV. All right? Okay, this is also an MRI. Then look at the images and see. What do you see there? This is a diffuse scar. This is a myocarditis. We find see this. Look at this.
Where is the location of this scar?
Right? So in myocarditis, because it is a diffuse inflammation of the myocardium, you will have myocardial edema in the first phase, then it becomes a scar. So this scar is maybe global, maybe focal and diffuse with skip areas, right? So it may be subepicardial, it may be subendocardial, or it may be midmyocardial, or a combination of all these things. Mixed pattern, myocarditis. There is also some, you also have shown some pericardial. Now, this X-ray I showed yesterday, the other day, adipose heart. You remember the one which came to me with a diagnosis of malignant, lung malignancy. They posted for thoracotomy and surgery. They wanted cardiologist clearance. And then we found that it was an adipose heart, not malignancy. Unlikely for the patient, he was a smoker. So that's a perfect, you know. Smoker, male, 40 plus years, and the shadow in the lung. Can't be anything other than malignancy in a cancer hospital. But it wasn't. Likely. This is the CT of the patient. Right? So you have three layers of fat. This is subcutaneous. Sorry. This is subcutaneous fat, okay, paracardiac fat. So they have no very bad influence on the heart, these two layers. And the third one, epicardial fat. You see that epicardial fat? Now, epicardial fat is the one which can produce diastolic dysfunction of the heart. Also produce obesity, cardiomyopathy, which I was mentioning the other day. This is also the one which produces a lot of chemokines and cytokines. It's an inflammatory fat. So the coronary arteries which are close to that develop intense atherosclerosis. So this is adipose heart. This is pretty clear. There are arrows there. So you can see those arrows. This is ALV thrombus. So thrombite generally you can make out an echo, but sometimes if the echo window is not good or you are not good enough, frequently that is so. We are not good enough. And you are in a hurry always. So just to do a routine examination. These days echo unfortunately has been boiled down to, filtered down to only one parameter. Ejection fraction.
Ejection fraction, harder
to do. Nothing more than that. It's very, very sad. Okay. So, are you able to appreciate the thrombus?
Sometimes it is very difficult when you are looking
at the apical thrombus. That is the thrombus?
Because when you are really looking at the apical view, there will be a lot of cracking of the apical. And people have reported any thrombus. What is the 100% foolproof way of diagnosing the effect of thrombus by
echocardiogram? Thrombus, can you present without reason or
issue? There are things shown even now recently before we.
Double leg.
I will be contrast. Contrast is open to my body.
Chamber.
Yeah.
Chamber of aspiration. A transpulmonary, if it is left ventricle, you need to have echo contrast. That is transpulmonary, goes to the left.
Understand the meaning of transpulmonary?
No, bubble contrast won't go on to the left side unless there is a right to left shunt. But if it is RV thrombus you are looking at, or if it is Epstein's, or RV cardiomyopathy, or RV EMF, bubble contrast is good. We have done many times. But if you are looking at LV, bubble contrast is no good. You have to do a transpulmonary echo, which is expensive. Or something like 10,000. You can get it, but expensive. We try to do it, but nobody is willing to pay the price. So the other way, suppose if you don't have echo contrast, the another way which you can use, another trick which we have used is you, instead of for adult frequency transducer like 2.5 megahertz or 2 megahertz transducer, you take 5 megahertz transducer, 5 to 7, like pediatric transducer. Then the apex, put the patient on the left, right, and then put the transducer, you can see the near near structures much better. The pediatric transducer. Other thing, of course, is contrast we discussed, and transesophageal echo. Transesophageal echo also, if you go into the mesophagus, or go into stomach and do a transgastric use, you can frequently look at the LVMs. But this is pretty simple MRI. Though it is more expensive, not available everywhere.
So that is thoracic also, you do it in the subcostal view. Then you can see the effects and then you can make that without having any confusion with the artifacts. But as I said, you know, rather the second.
First pass training.
But nowadays, nobody has done. If you got a contrast, you contrast, otherwise you go for a month.
Okay.
Right now we have a patient who has suspected this thing. He also has IC, so we can do a mother. And I tried to get some contrast.
What are the contraindications for MRI?
ICD. ICD.
But if the ICD was MRI treated, it
MRI compatible, but I don't think we had it done almost about 7-8 years ago. So at that time,
but when these people do the device check,
yeah,
it will also give information whether it is MRI machine done.
Yeah, yeah. No, but I'm quite certain it's not MRI compatible.
MRI data is available up to 1.5 tests.
Right.
3 Tesla, we don't know.
3 Tesla, they are not supposed to do it. They say MRI conditional is the correct word for this day. Conditional in the sense up to 1.5 Tesla. But beyond that, they say don't do it.
Another technique is the patient is not dependent on thing. Then temporarily you can, it has some mechanism whereby you can shut it off. Yeah, what is this? Sorry, that exists. When you see the multi-septated cyst-like structure, this is a hydrated cyst. Can you see that this is the hydrated cyst with multi-septate? But remember, hydrated may be without any septate. It can be multi-septated or single septum or completely without. There are different organisms which produce different types. This is multi-septated. And this is very good. MRI is very, in fact, echo also is good. But then MRI, you are directly looking at it. All said and done, echo is operator dependent. But MRI, only blind can see. Right? I don't know how many radiologists are there. I made a very inflammatory comment. This you should be able to tell. It's not a very great diagnostic. I made it slightly confusing intentionally. But actually, it is a straightforward diagnosis.
What kind of image is this?
First, see what are the structures you are seeing, what are the chambers, valves, where is this abnormality present?
Is it contrast or no contrast? So is it CT or a
CT?
CT. In chambers are specified.
Is a contrast in that mass or in the chamber? Mass, does it have the contrast? It's a myxoma. It's a classical myxoma. I intentionally did not show you the cine group of the CT. That classically shows that movement which you see on echo. This is a myxoma. This is very tough. Nobody made diagnosis. Actually, I have the videos, unfortunately, they are not running. I have in the other which you copy, the same that. Maybe at the end of this presentation, we'll show the timing. And now it is not in this file. We have to change the file. I will give you a background. This is approximately 55-year-old man, smoker, at chest pain, treated in Karimnagar by a local nursing home. They gave him some drugs which we don't know what was given, right? Then he developed chest pain again. Then he came to our hospital in Nampally, where the cardiologist who was in the echo made some diagnosis. All right. The surgeon was not happy with that. So they sent the images over to me. So I was not happy with the diagnosis made by my colleague, and I was also not happy with my own assessment. I did not know what it is, but I knew what it was not. It was not what the cardiologist thought in number, but I didn't know what it was. Nobody knew till he was open. Okay. But unfortunately, do you know what was the diagnosis given in Nampal by the echocardiologist? Myxoma. The only question I asked is, this is the cystic structure. So how can you make a diagnosis of myxoma? Myxoma is a solid structure. Unless myxoma is infected and becomes an abscess, you don't see it as a cyst at all. A degenerative myxoma, which is rare, infected with abscess in myxoma, there only you can see something like this. Otherwise, it can't be a myxoma. So I told them, this is anything, but definitely not myxoma. What is it? I don't know. We have to see. So finally, went to the theater, was operated. The surgeon also didn't know what it is. He was thinking it is some tumor or mass or something like that. He tried to take a biopsy of that by putting in a needle. The minute he punctured it, collapsed. It was a hematoma. It was a left atrial intramural hematoma. So the left atrial intramural hematoma. So when this information came to me, I said, now the diagnosis is very straightforward. Left atrial intramural hematoma. They sent it for histopathology. Pathologist said there is nothing there except RBC and there are some fibrin threads, etc. Nothing else. Then we started digging the literature. There were very, very few publications. One from, I think, Gujarat. In India, there was one publication from Gujarat. Atrial intramural hematoma as a result of a parent and antiplatelet drugs which he received in probably. Okay. Then we did an MRI before surgery. So MRI showed the same thing what you can see here. That is a mass. You are able to see that it is coming from the roof of the left atrium. Okay, that is a very unusual site for myxoma. Very unusual. And two, myxoma is a solid structure and not a cyst. And three, this did not take up gadolinium. Myxoma also does not take up gadolinium unless there is an infection. Infected myxomas can take up gadolinium. But this did not take up gadolinium. It was extremely rare. I think this is the only time I saw a patient with intramural hematoma of the left atrium. We have seen intramural hematoma of the ventricular myocardium, left ventricle and right ventricle in acute MI, or post-cath you traumatize them and produce hematomas.
Post-infarct.
That is common. But these were not diagnosed, say, some 15 years back, because these investigative techniques were not there. It's very sensitive to pick up intramyocardial hematoma. Okay. This is very rare. This is the only case I saw. Myocarditis, you can see the scar, mid-myocardial scar. Can you see that? Here it is a mid-myocardial scar, all over. Okay? Here you see, except this area, there is scar everywhere. Okay. image of image, you go and see what is up north.
Eventually, you just...
Don't jump.
Right here.
Must be very focused. This is hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. I don't know why you are finding it different. This is one of the easier things in this presentation. See this septum, which is massively hypertrophied. Okay? Look at the posterior wall. Obviously, there is an asymmetrical septal hypertrophy. MRI is extremely useful in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. It has become a big subject on its own now. Many, many things may be there, which we were not seeing earlier. So this demonstrates only one of those findings, scarring. Well, hypertrophic cardiomyopathy with scarring behaves very badly. Particularly if the scar is more than 15% of the total myocardium. So the risk is sudden cardiac death. All right? Then heart failure later on. Longevity is abbreviated. So these are the patients, even if there were no symptoms, they are eligible for ICD now. ICD is one of the greatest developments in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, but is the only one shown to prolong the life of the hypertrophic cardiomyopathy patients. Normally, if you look at your, you don't have that image here. If you take the short axis images, where the myocardium, the ventricular septum inserts into the left ventricle and right ventricle, hinge points are there. Suppose this is a ventricle. This is septum. Let us say this is septum, this is all left ventricle. Right? This is one hinge point between the septum and LV. This is another hinge point between the... Here scarring is quite normal in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. It is not bad prognostic sign. But if there is scarring anywhere else, then it is bad. Okay? And we can estimate the scar burden. That is one. And two, we can also find abnormal mitral valve and papillary muscle apparatus on MRI. We can also find left ventricular apical sump aneurysm, which also has a high risk in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. We can also find the mitral valve abnormalities. We can also find, so one third of them have right ventricular hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. So we can also find right ventricular involvement, which is about one third, though the echo lab rarely ever reports it. And then gadolinium enhancement in the atria and the atrial septum. It is common in amyloidosis, but also common in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. So if you have an atrial gadolinium enhancement, it is evidence that these are the people who will soon develop atrial fibrillation. So they may in fact be candidates for your blood thinners. Blood thinners, like, you know, you have so many of them now. All right? So either vitamin K antagonists or direct oral anticoagulant drugs, they are eligible for that if there is a lot of scarring of the left atrium. Here, where is the scar? You can see massive scarring. This is the septum. See this? Ventricular septum is massive scar. And also see inferior wall. There is a lot of scarring here. All right, coming down here, similar thing is shown. This is big scar in the ventricular septum mid myocardium, and then you have the inferior wall. So now, when you make a diagnosis of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, MRI of the heart is absolute necessity. Absolute necessity. Echo is not good enough any longer. Echo is good to give you hemodynamics of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, but not good enough for everything. So you need to do MRI for every patient of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. You can even pick up. You can even pick up patients who are otherwise looking normal in the family screening. And you do a family screening, there may be no asymmetrical septal hypertrophy at all. ECG may be normal, no symptoms. All right, but still there is one evidence on MRI which can tell you this is a patient who is going to develop hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. That is, there are what are called as myocardial crypts, 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 wedge-like deficits in the endomyocardium. These crypts will show you that these are the people who already had early evidence of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy.
Now, one of the roles of MRI in HCM is you can, there are some patients of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy who have mitral wall abnormalities, including what do you call displacement of the papillary muscles, very long anterior to the mitral wall. And it is sometimes difficult to identify that clinically. Even by echocardiography, it is different, although it's not actually you can do that. But MRI is supposed to be now the gold standard for identifying the displacement of the papillary muscles and primary abnormal groups of T. Anyway, clinically, can you pick them up? Echocardiogram cannot pick up, but clinically, can you pick them up? Then the clinical sign, by which you say if that is present, then we see the primary abnormality of the mitral wall. Most of them will have mitral regurgitation, right? But in the classical HOCM, the mitral regurgitation is proportional to the degree of pulmonary obstruction. Otherwise, uncomplicated HCM. But in patients who are having primary abnormalities, the mitral wall, the mitral regurgitation is independent of the LVOT obstruction. How do we recognize it clinically at the bedside? To do a maneuver of swatting, what happens to the obstruction?
Squatting.
Squatting increases. LVOT obstruction increases. So the LVOT obstruction decreases. What should happen to the mitral regurgitation? It should decrease. Now, so if you spot a patient, the LVOT movement decreases, but MR movement increases, then there is a primary abnormality of the mitral. This is given in a master book. You read the chapter on physical examination. Different regimen. So one of the big advantages of spotting in HOCM is so the LVOT movement increases, but the MR movement increases, then there is the primary abnormality of the mitral wall.
Then the mitral regurgitation in hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy can be of two varieties or three varieties. Three varieties, let me say. One is related to the sign. Well, itself is normal, related to sign. And the MR will be eccentric, posterior eccentric. Right? Suppose if the MR is due to primary disease of the mitral valve, then it tends to be central MR.
One of the ways of suspecting is a primary abnormality of the mitral valve. The MR valve is central.
Now, the mitral valve may be primarily involved in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, either because of mitral annular calcification, which is pretty common in them, mitral annular calcification. In fact, that may even produce mitral stones also. I have 5 patients, hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, mitral annular calcification, severe mitral stones. Or they may develop infective endocarditis and mitral regurgitation. Or because of the subvalvular papillary muscle abnormalities. So you have to keep all those things in mind. So this is another patient. So what do you find? This is classic of something. Where is this car? I think it moved on. File has changed. I must have touched something. This is a
great problem.
The file is different.
Most is mine.
It's hardly more.
So where do you see this car here? That is a classic location for Fabry's disease. Inferior lateral. Right? So if you find a patient is looking like hypertrophic cardiomyopathy and echo, has a scar in the inferior and or lateral, it is Fabry's, till proven otherwise. Then look for other evidences of Fabry's. They may have angiokeratoma, they may have renal dysfunction, right? Also, you need to look for evidence of Fabry's. And then every patient with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, you must think of Fabry's. Though Fabry is much much more rarer than hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, I think I have seen only about probably 6 or 7, not more than that. But why you should make OTs? Fabry's is curable. Lifelong enzyme replacement therapy, you can cure it. It is costly, monthly 50 lakh rupees.
I have one patient who suspected that oncogenesis. He couldn't recover. He said, you know, he can't recover.
You must get alpha gal. Non patients with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, unless Fabry has been ruled out already by proper investigation. Alpha gal can be done in Hyderabad. You get it, it is available. Not every lab does it. There are a few labs where you can do
it.
There is one in Banjara Hills near that mosque. Banjara Hills road number 3 is a mosque. In that locality, there is one trust diagnostic center. Sondron something. In fact, it is cheap there.
Actually, I got it done in CC ambulance.
Main condition is patch. It's a trust diagnosis. Right? So you need to remember 2 things. One, every patient where there is a diagnosis of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, you need to rule out Fabry's disease, you need to rule out amyloidosis. Alright? 2, if you find a scar in this location, Fabry goes up in the differential diagnosis. It becomes more likely. So you must get an alpha gal. and also look for the other systemic evidences of Anderson Gradley disease. His full name is Anderson Gradley disease. So, what do you find? There are arrows. I was a fool to put them. I don't think we'll be able to make out. This is hemochromatosis. It's all iron. It is being shown there is iron. The arrows are showing the iron in the myocardium, the liver. So this is a patient picked up from the thalassemia. Every month there is a thalassemia club in Chikungabad. You may be knowing because of the so they have 800 children with thalassemia. They come for blood transfusion, etc. There. One of my uncle who is an industrialist, pharma industry, he donated 2 crores for that thalassemia club. They also have money from other sources. From all over the state, they come there. So, Dr. Nageshwar Rao, pediatric cardiologist, used to run once in 4 months or 5 months, something like that, screening of them for hemochromatosis. That they get blood transfusions. This is one of the patients who picked up. Right? Now, the MRI is absolutely diagnostic. Two, it can actually give you quantification of the iron. There is some formula, which I don't remember to tell you. There is some formula whereby you can actually estimate so much iron is there in the heart, so much iron is there in the liver. That is useful. Yeah, that is useful in knowing whether your therapy is benefiting the patient or not. What do you find? What did you say?
Non-convex.
Okay. That is all? You look at everything. The left ventricle is dilated, right? Left ventricle is dilated and then? Cavity is globular in shape. Then left atrium appears dilated, which means there is a not only non-compaction is there is cardiomyopathy. And there is systolic dysfunction of the ventricle. Maybe there is also some mitral. This is straightforward. I'm sorry for keeping it there. This is almost insulting. It's not the total. The arrow is only one thing which is pointing out.
Anybody can see. What are the things you are supposed to look at in a patient? No, but what determines the outcome? What is the location of the obstruction?
Location, length, severity, collaterals, aortic valve, aorta, dissection.
Is it hypoplastic or normal or?
Is there a duct? Sometimes they may be duct. What about the left subclavian?
How far away can you do this entry? How far away is the left subclavian can be?
When right subclavian may be coming anomalous. Spread the other day I showed you one. So there is so much to describe. The lesson is just because there is an arrow there and jump to coa. I mean nobody will give you even 1 mark for that. So what else is there? The total description is important. abstains. But you haven't described abstains. He said RV is dilated. RV is not dilated.
RV
is dilated. So where is the tricuspid valve? Oh, you haven't described it like a part of it. This is abstinence. You are right, but for wrong reasons.
Yeah. That's where the problem was with the candidate. The examiner might think he got the clue from somebody else in the examination. Not necessarily this examination. But previously, we used to think of that.
Not only you should say abstinence, you should say abstinence anomaly of right sided tricuspid valve.
Right sided AV valve, you must say.
Should be complete.
Can you get abstinence anomaly of the left sided AV? Can you get abstinence anomaly of the left sided AV valve? Okay. So why that happens? Is it mitral wall or tricuspid wall? Left side.
CCD or left side is.
There is a ventricular inversion.
No,
ventricular is on the left side.
Ventricular transposition is double inversion. If you have ventricular discordance, then ventricular inversion. That's why the circulation is corrected, but the anatomy is not correct. So,
and leaflets, actually, once you say abstinence, there is displacement. You also need to describe which leaflets are involved. No, in a given patient, we are giving theoretical knowledge, that is not what I want. In a given patient, and there are other things also, if there is an abstinence, you have to look for. If there is any inflatory communication, and how big it is. And whether there is tricuspid stenosis, whether there is tricuspid regurgitation, how much of ventricle is atrialized? So whether it is surgically correctable or not. There are so many issues. Why we are interested in congenital heart disease? Because they will go to the surgeon. Surgeon must get all information. Because diagnosis one line is not good enough at all at your speed. I will give you the story of this girl. She is 12 years, same girl. Had some hopes in the school, and also at home. She was seen by a psychiatrist and under treatment from a psychiatrist, right? And when this happened, the girl had a syncope again in the school. She was rushed to the emergency room. Then things followed. Huh?
Right.
Right. But you're not saying loud. When you don't say loud and
loud and clear,
it means that you are not sure about your tongue. That is almost incomplete. That of course is marked there, so what?
Dilatation of pulmonary artery.
No. Now, what is called vascular leftment? Is it done by the angle of 28?
And maybe it's not loose.
Alka Bhan. Myocardial arthritis.
What arthritis? There are tracheations. You don't have tracheations.
No, I'll tell you.
Something had a left mainstream thing.
I'll tell you, something like this happened to one of the doctor's daughter. She didn't believe that she was having. She was a college going, inter first year. She kept on having, what you call chest pain, and then lie down prone, and then the parents fell. Both are doctors. One mother is a doctor, father is a doctor. I didn't believe her. And she was almost taken to a psychiatrist. Monday she came, and then she fainted, and this time she literally had a syncope and nobody was there in the house. Neighbor called the parents, and by the time they came, he was complaining of chest pain, severe. So he called me up, sorry, what should I do? I said, guess, get an ECG while the patient is having pain. ECG was done. It was ST segment depression of 5 millimeters throughout the leads. I said, you know, she's not what is called functional, it's a definite organ. And at that age, it can be only one thing. You know, so I sat there, they had to investigate. She was admitted here with us, but they went to Star Hospital because, which Star Hospital, where the Ramesh did the extending of the left hand.
This guy is called extending of the left hand, but Raghura was.
No, no, extending of the left hand, the story did not end. Then she went abroad for higher education, 2 years down the line. Then in college campus, she again fainted. So they took the patient and then did the angio. They said, no, it's again closed and we'll do a CABD. Take the CABD, we have to LED. Without realizing that it is left subtail instead of. Then she had failure of the thing. Again, they had to extend.
Coronary stream. So, ostial stenosis, there are very few conditions. And that age, younger, or to arthritis. Otherwise, in 50s, 60s, era, 1960s, syphilis, ruticavotitis was ostial disease, coronary. And radiation of the chest produces ostial stenosis. Mediastinitis also produces ostial stenosis. And then papillary fibroelastoma, aortic valve, if there is a long stalk, it will be obstructing the ostia of the coronary artery. Right? Then aortic tumors. Dissection of the aorta can produce ostial stenosis. All right? And then our procedures. Diagnostic coronary angiogram, or you are doing an angioplasty for some other vessel, or during a cardiac surgery for something, they give the cardioplegia.
Post surgery,
you can
angulate the coronary artery for cardioplegia.
They develop ostial stenosis.
And we have, I see one patient, that was in a young lady, but she was taking some hormones, but I don't think hormones were connected with the spontaneous infection. But she had a spontaneous infection and then she had severe pain and other things. So we get a diagnosis. But I never suspected it could be a spontaneous dissection of the infection. It was spontaneous infection. Usually we see that kind of thing in the peripartum, not pre-pregnancy or not in a stage of birth.
The congenital things is very rarely children have valve at the mouth of the left hand. Coronaries don't have valves. Rarely they may have a valve. Or feet like ostium, congenital.
They say that intramural goes.
That thing was mentioned.
It goes within the wall and the aorta sometime before it comes out. There's a good review article, pathological description of this congenital coronary anomaly by E.N.C. Roberts. Description of all types of variations of this.
And also the surgeons, when they transplant the coronaries, a transposition when they do the switch is a common complication, ostial coronary stenosis. Right? So, but here it is a auto-arthritis.
But you have told that 20-year-old girl having a problem like that.
I did not make up the story. Whatever I am telling you is the real story. 15 years, I said 12, 13, which is
15.
This one is an MRI. there are two signs of Valsalva. There is an arrow there, you can see. This one.
Where is it ruptured?
Then here also you can see here. Not a very big rupture.
It is.
All right. This is a double chambered right ventricle. See this? This is dividing the right ventricle into two chambers. Something went back. And this is also very good to look at the pulmonary arteries. Quite frequently in some of these patients on echo, you may not be very sure of the right pulmonary artery, left pulmonary artery, or intrapulmonary pulmonary arteries. Then this is very good. You can see the RPS stenosis. This is RPS stenosis. This is extremely rare. I don't think he'll make out because we did not
describe.
Actually, describe what structures you are seeing. What looks abnormal?
I don't know the structures in the first action. Possible structure in
the pulmonary artery in a fistula, right pulmonary artery is draining into the pulmonary vein.
So what is the clinical picture like?
Like a pulmonary artery in a fistula, like any other pulmonary artery, except that the location and the vessels involved are different.
Usually it is in the lower lobes.
This is RPA, main RPA, draining directly into pulmonary.
And then
you have done an angio. Subsequently, this was closed. Now it's closed. The CT coronary, VRT maze.
Right coronary from the left or left coronary from the right?
Right coronary from the left.
You see it here, it is, you can make out here. You may get confused here, but here you can see. All the three are coming from the left. It's a single coronary. This one?
This is able to tell.
Just see the
marking. The arrows and other is earlier things there. There's something running between the two arteries.
Actually, you can go worse than blind. See, I have written here right coronary artery, left circumflex, left coronary artery. Circumflex should come from the right, left coronary artery. It is coming from the right coronary artery. Where is it going? It's going between aorta and the pulmonary artery. It is an interarterial cross.
What is the importance?
Did you understand? Not in all of them. There are two types. Interarterial course at the muscular level of the arteries. Interarterial course at the fibrous level of the artery. At the fibrous level, it is not dangerous. At the muscular level, because it can contract and expand, it compresses the coronary artery during exercise or whatever. So that variety is malignant. If it is interfibrous, it is not malignant. It has no problem. So if it is intermuscular, it is malignant. If they are symptomatic, they need to undergo the procedure where you bypass it. What did you say?
What is not there? PA, what is coming out? Do you get any coronary artery from PA? How many?
Yeah, it is Alkapa. For some purpose, I marked them.
Yeah.
This is aorta. This is the right coronary artery. Multiple coiled ones. Then it is connected with the left coronary artery. This left coronary artery is connected to PA. Anomalous left coronary artery arising from the multiple intercoronary collaterals. They not be placed to continuous manner, and they may not have serious problem. Because there are no collaterals, they will look like dilated coronary.
What do you do in the picture right in this patient? Will they come to you with what? So many collateral you will get in there? Do they have microwave agitation at this with this point? Definitely some patients, huh?
Descending the what? The classical picture of coronary disease. What is this? Kawasaki. Kawasaki.
Kawasaki. What is this?
Coronary disease. Kawasaki.
What is Kawasaki disease?
Arthritis.
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 Arthritis. No, no, that is only incidental. But what do they come with?
Fish
pond. Do they come with chest pain? How many cases of thumbs have you seen so far?
One.
Yeah. Usually they come with other symptoms. Diarrhea, for example, in other important of the
ulcers.
So, basically.
The oldest I've seen was 91 years.
Kawasaki.
And that guy, for some reason, had coronary CT. Which were multiple coronary. This we have already seen. Yeah, we see. But you can see it very nicely, the right ventricle and fatty replacement. All those arrows you can see. They're two different patients. Okay. This is very, again, very, very rare. The prevention in some conference.
I'd like to speak up a bit loud, whatever you think.
Feeling
it.
Which is going to be picked up, there is a mass.
Mass. Same mass.
What is that mass? Where from it is coming? What is the shape of the mass? How many masses are there? Where
from?
Where from to where? From where to where?
Extending from apex to.
The very rare thing is a warm hyperdysmotophilia. There was hyperdysmotophilia, about 70% plus something like in this particular patient. So we thought hyperdysmotophilia induced DLB thrombus. And it is operated, it was actually a hoopworm. But whatever you are seeing, we thought it was thrombus. Actually, it was a worm. No? Intracardiac worm. Nobody made this diagnosis, so don't be depressed. This is again extremely rare condition. I will tell you the background story. He is middle aged, I don't remember the age, probably around 40, something like that. He was sent by a cardiologist from outside. He was already seen by 3 or 4 cardiologists. Now we discussed this in our bedside case discussion for the students. The referring diagnosis was F-students. So we examined along with the students. We said, it is anything but F-students. What it is, we don't know. But it is not F-students. Okay, then we carried on. We did the echo ourselves. One of my colleagues did the echo. He came out with some diagnosis of this, which I did not agree. Because it was his patient, he sent him to surgeon. It was not what he thought. I will tell you what it is. I will first describe it. It's very interesting. This is the first time I've seen this. This is the right ventricle. Okay. The shape is very abnormal. RV is dilated. Actually, the apex is found by the RV. It is wrapping, this is called exactly wrapping around LV and LV apex. and the LV is posterior and roundish, spherical and small. We are not seeing here, but on echo we could see that the papillary muscles were displaced superiorly and anteriorly. We are not seeing it in MRI. We saw it on echo. That is there in another file. I don't know whether we'll have enough time to see that. So then CT was done. My colleague got a CT done. There were some specks of calcium. So his diagnosis was constrictive pericarditis. Right? And then during the echo, I was standing there, right? Because it was a class of the students. And I said, this is not constrictive pericarditis. This looks like diagnosis A. That I will tell you later. Then I forgot all about it. Then he got an CT done. There were calcifications on the pericardium. He sent to the surgeon for pericardium. Surgeon, for some reason, he thought that it was my patient. So from the theater, he opened and then called me. And he said, your patient with constrictive pericarditis, we are operating. I don't find anything wrong. The pericardium is very thin. A little bit of flaky calcium here and there. But pericardium is okay, normal. But I can't find the left ventricle. I can't find the left ventricle where it is. Then I said, I don't know, I just saw only the echo on that day, that was almost 2 weeks before. I made a diagnosis of congenital LV apical hypoplasia. It is a rare condition. Congenital LV apical hypoplasia, in that LV will be posterior and roundish, RV will be dilated, it wraps around the left ventricle. Papillary muscle will be displaced. That's what I thought. So, if we are not able to see the left ventricle, if the heart is posterior. So, he called me after 15-20 minutes and said, yes, it is there, but it is very small. Very small, roundish left ventricle is there posterior. And he asked me, what should he do? So, don't do anything, close it. There is nothing you can do. So, he closed it. But whatever pericardium, initially thought it was constrictive, so he removed a little bit of pericardium. He sent it for histopathology. Now, pathologist now calls and says, the diagnosis is constrictive pericarditis, but it is normal pericardium. Everybody thought it was my patient, so they were calling me. So this was this is the only case I saw. Congenital LV apical hypoplasia. It was not Epstein's, it was not constrictive, but it was operated, but closed. Nothing was done except congenital LV apical hypoplasia. Just remember, there is some entity like that. First, identify what is that investigation? Is it CT, is it contrast angio, is it MRI, is it PET CT, is it plain chest X-ray? MRI angiogram, okay. What are the structures you are seeing?
Karchita. Pan off.
And then what happened to the size of the
tapering of size of the
well, there are three images. 1, 2, 3. Okay. First, tell us about the first image. That is white blood image.
That shows the lobe.
sitting on the wall of the area?
There is a diffuse narrowing of the descending thoracic aorta. Ascending, transverse, proximal descending aorta. From here to lower down, particularly here, there is a severe narrowing of the descending thoracic aorta up to even abdominal aorta.
How old is the patient?
This patient roughly is about 25 to 30. Woman.
Woman, yeah.
And then what is this test? So gadolinium enhancement. Look at the wall of the aorta. They're looking like as if it is calcified. It's not calcium. That is uptake of the gadolinium in the wall of the aorta. What does it signify? Inflammation. There is acute inflammation of the aorta, thoracic aorta. Same thing you can demonstrate on PET CT also. These days actually we are doing PET CT. This was done few years back. From here to here, you are seeing the gadolinium uptake in the aorta. This is called macrony sign. When you are doing an echo, if you just look at the abdominal aorta, you can make out this the macrony sign.
You understand the meaning of macrony sign?
Macrony. What is macrony?
Macrony is also you don't know what macrony.
No, if you go to a buffet dinner,
you get. This is that depicts the nature of the arthritis, no?
It is all around. It's
all around, circular. I don't know how there is this in the mark.
The classical aortoarthritis. What is the significance of gadolinium uptake? It means there is an acute infarction. Yeah, these are the patients who will be benefited by immunomodulators. Steroids, methotrexate, azathioprine, some combination or other. These are the people where this inflammation will subside with immunomodulators. Right? That is importance of gadolinium or PET CT. Burnt out the aortitis, they won't take up PET, they won't take up gadolinium. 16 years.
This macaroni sign actually described by the ultrasound or the analytics. Or actually, you get that kind of a high intensity image of the artery. There is one way of distinguishing, we had one patient who was discussed here in this very rare case, but I also want to tell you, I have to serve up this one. Yeah, I know. But at that time, you know, he had involvement of the IDX and also similar. I said, it cannot be, I don't want to. The time they know when we decide even you do the ultrasonogram on the thyroid and then try the anatomy of the wall of the heart. Because sometimes it's a disease of the state of the artery. It cannot be here, all of them are none of them. It cannot be here. Somebody is on the other hand, they don't teach it. Is primarily a disease of eczema, secondary changes in the
medial sclerosis, monkey body sclerosis, there is a different variety.
By looking at the cross-section anatomy of the artery, you will be able to start think of the possible cause of the alcohol vasculitis. That is the whole idea is you can see the whether arthritis is a pan arthritis. It involves intima, media, and arthritis. Referral is only a disease of the intima, the secondary pain system. So the cardinal sign is showing that there is pan arthritis, especially involving the arthritis. Well, one of the signs, one of the best used for different diagnosis, when you are looking at it, it means data serving for borderline zone, where it is an iodoarthritis, and then a closer. And the macular sign was described in the ultrasonogram of the.
Well, this is an asymptomatic patient, cardiac surgery done in 2002, 8 years back. This I showed you the other day.
The rare one.
Submitral annular aneurysm. Mitral valve replacement was done. This surgical trauma, which has produced a submitral annular aneurysm. It can be congenital, can be secondary to mitral valve surgery, it can be secondary to infective endocarditis. There are three varieties. Okay. Fourth variety is being talked about now, what is called MAD, M-A-D, mitral annular disjunction. Have you heard of that?
Very much in the news, most of the scientific.
MAD, mitral annular disjunction.
The cardiology clinics, what you have got with right now, mitral valve disease, that is the issue has been given to all of you. Mitral valve is a special issue only on imaging. One of the chapters is mitral annular disjunction.
So mitral annular disjunction is reversed by abstinence anomaly. So the posterior mitral leaflet attachment is up into the left edge. So there is a distance between the attachment of the posterior mitral leaflet and the top of the posterior wall of the left edge. There is a thin tissue there. If it is more than 9 millimeters, it is up. That is what is called as a mitral annular disjunction. So this mitral annular disjunction is considered to be responsible for sudden cardiac death in mitral valve prolapse and also Marfan syndrome. And now they are also thinking that the congenital submitral annular aneurysm, the original reason is MAD, mitral annular disjunction.
It has been described in the optical literature actually, East African countries.
This was called actually African aneurysm, those days.
Yeah.
Black aneurysm, African aneurysm was original. So these can be there, submitral annular, congenital, sub-aortic annular, or both. I'm going to show you one more. This patient, you saw the chest X-ray the other day, same patient. This is sub-aortic annular. This is an young male. This is sub-aortic annular. So if it is a sinus valsalva aneurysm, that is the differential diagnosis.
You know what is the cause of the valsalva? There is a failure of the union of the mitral annulus with the wall. Not mitral annulus, aortic annulus. There is injection there. That forms the area of weakness. That really causes the aneurysm of sinusal valve.
So why is this important? because when it is growing here, it can rupture. That is one. Two, there may be thrombus, it can embolize. Three, this is where you get the left coronary. So depending on the direction it is growing, it might compress the left main or may compress the left anterior descending. Produce ischemia, infarct, sudden death, etc., etc. So that is the reason why this is extremely important and they need to be operated. Most of the time, these people are quite young. This patient is in his 20s, if I remember that. We had total about 13 patients combined. So about 6 of my clients, total 13 patients. And in them, two of them had both sub-aortic cannula and sub-mitral. So two of them.
I have one patient with mitral valve protection in the followed up with a mild mitral regurgitation. And then she got married to some NRI and then went to US. Then she had sudden worsening of the mom, for whatever reason, according to the father of the girl. And she had to be taken for a surgery. And to their horror, they found the subvolar mitral. They could not repair it. She died on the tube in years.
They don't know this condition.
Yeah, they don't.
This patient also died. Was operated. This one. This one was operated.
Oh, that father was so.
He thought
she would be very safe in the USA, getting operated. But I was also surprised. I mean, said that.
No, they have no clue. I tell you, during the echo discussion, I thought I will make a statement. I was giving a lecture about 7-8 years back in Texas, Arkansas, on cardiology. There were about 60-65 of them. Most of them are resident cardiology fellows. Few of them are faculty. I showed them about 28 or 29 echoes, only echoes.
Okay.
It's like a quiz. You know, they could answer only two or three of them. Even those two or three which were answered by Indians from the originally were from all instruments. So they have no clue about many of the things which we talk about. This patient also died. He did not come off the bypass. Though the diagnosis was made preoperative, but still he died.
That was not made preoperative, that was before the era that was heart exam. I'm talking about 1978, 79. And he did not, actually, you'll be surprised that we did not have echo facilities in Hyderabad till 83, 84.
And in 80, we had a moment.
But then, do you know who were the first to be echo in Hyderabad and in state of Telangana and in state of Andhra Pradesh?
Hmm?
It was Vijay Diagnostics. He had an Aloka to be echo. I used to go there and then do the echoes. I was trying to learn the echoes at that point in time. The 2D echo was very
new. The Himaitanagar, the Rashid Bhagavatam. That was the only center they had.
Yeah.
Now they have some 100 centers. So they had the first choice.
Yeah.
He did not have color. No doctor,
right.
No color.
Right. But they had a pulse doctor, but they had no color down. But that was the one way I thought it was clinically an extension of the. But when I did the echo at the time, turned out to be right again. So
the first thing was MOD. In 1980 also Gandhi
was there. Gandhi was there and the after Hyderabad was there and then the Meridar. That's some fun from some other private sources. Some Modi Foundation was there in Sekhara. He gave the money and then they got the MODA.
Near the Tranigan that are
the road. Exactly. So, that was the first MODA we had in the city of Hyderabad. Then Brahmaji Rao was very upset because how can you get an echo in Gandhi Hospital before being given to Usmani?
No, he always, he is dead now, so I think will leave it at that. You quantify the.
When did you mark it?
2 months back, or a year or 2 months. No, 3-4. For 3-4,
yeah, yeah.
2 years.
He was in Bangalore.
The obituary came in the newspaper.
He was in Bangalore, I thought.
Went to Bangalore after retirement to stay with his son. And then he was the medical superintendent of some kind of trust hospital. There, the staff and he did not get along there. They went on strike, so he resigned. Subsequently, his wife had ovarian cancer and all that. And he had bypass surgery, so finally he had Alzheimer's and death. So during the, when Sampath was head of the department, he organized a get together of the Hispanians, cardiology Hispanians. When he came to me, I said, during the Brahmas in Bangalore, whether he comes or not, he just invited him because he was the first cardiologist. He
not called him. It's a mistake.
I will come.
He was the first cardiologist.
I will come.
I will come.
He called up Prabhupada. And I believe he scolded him somehow. He didn't know who are you, why are you calling me, why are you inviting me? Something like that. He had some psycho.
No, he always had a problem with the personal
relationship. Passed away 2 years. That is such. He was 45 years now. I think it is done. You can go to
the last.
Go to the other file. Something go file soon. Go file. You may quickly go through some rare cases.
Which one?
Just put it to the first one.
Which?
It was there. No? What you did just now.
This is
10-15 minutes, please.
Alright.
So this is a 23-year-old male. As you can see, he had fever and he has fits. And he had pulmonary tuberculosis. And he had a congenital deafness, so he had a cochlear implant, which was infected, then re-implanted. Then he also had a maxillary sinusitis. That aspergillosis positive was found out after our study, though it is written here in that, but was not the initial diagnosis. But after we found the cardiac aspergillosis, then we were wondering where from this has come. And we started investigating and found that he had a maxillary sinusitis. Culture showed the acid. So this is all the description of that. This is the ECG. Originally, we thought this was a malignant tumor of the mediastinum invading all chambers. LV, RA, LV, atrial septum, interventricular septum, superior vena cava. The right pulmonary artery. There was a mediastinal mass. There was an extrinsic compression of the right pulmonary artery and small pericardial infection. Right? So then a biopsy was done. The histopathology had shown
Hello.
So you can see that there's an echo, right? So what are you seeing here? There's a mass which is coming into the left atrium. All right. So this is the flow. These are videos actually. Unfortunately, I have videos for this. And if you can hear the videos, you can appreciate it. Okay, let us stop. All right, next, then a few more videos.
It is gravitary masses?
That's what we thought.
Yeah, but
subsequently, there are many more images. Let us do it. Next. This is a short axis. Now you see that this mass is invading the atrial septum, ventral septum, left atrium, right atrium, everything. I never seen like this thing before.
I had one case where it was suspected like this, and extensive compression, I suspected it. Finally, when they did the surgery, it was iris hernia behind the left atrium.
After this, we saw
it was protruding into the left atrium.
After this, we had one more patient looking like this, not so extensive, but something like this. It was an angiosarcoma of the pulmonary vein growing into the left atrium.
That was growing a huge problem.
So you get a better idea here.
Yeah.
Both atria and atrial septum. Yeah. There is a CT also. I want to show you the CT. So this is all the mass. Look at that mass. Now you get a better idea. It is all over.
All over, yeah.
So we thought this is some kind of mediastinum tumor malignant invading the cardiac thing, but it turned out to be aspergillosis. You can see the spores. This one. Can you see that? There's the aspergillus filament and the spore. These are all the spores.
Black fungus.
It has it. This is
the black fungus. Maker.
That is the filament. This is a enlargement. This is a filament. And then you can see the spores. Where are we? Yeah, okay. It's okay. This is the one which I showed you. LV apical hypoplasia condition. This is the echo of that patient. From the separate
file.
This is the right ventricle, which is wrapping around the left.
I often wondered, what was the systemic doctor is that?
No. Maybe you can see it better here.
No, but the cavity itself is so small.
This is a measuring because the reference diagnosis was extended. We are looking for displacement electrodiagnostic value. Maybe some CT. So these are the calciums which are interpreted as pericardial calcium constitutive pericardial by one of the units. So one lesson here is calcium in the pericardium is not equivalent to constitutive
pericardium.
Equivalent of the pericardium is not equivalent to constitutive. Calcium in the pericardium is not equivalent to constitutive.
It's very important to know that you can have constriction without the birth of pericarditis.
I have an example that I need to show. There is what is called as a subacute effusive constrictive pericarditis with a reversible constrictive pericarditis. I have many examples of that. Reversible constrictive pericarditis. So this is the one which I showed you.
This is the video.
This is the video of that. See, this is the right atrium, banana shaped right ventricle. It is wrapping around the LV. LV is the small structure which my surgeon could not find. So he was wondering what happened to the LV. Right? There is another sign which I did not mention. Now you can see. The fat invasinates into the gap between RV and LV. This is also described as one of the signs on MRI. Right? And papillary muscles will be displaced superiorly and anteriorly. So RV wrapping around the LV. Small roundish posterior left ventricle and then fat invasinating between the gap between RV and RV, displacement of the papillary muscle. These are the quad of the congenital LV ventricle axis. This they list under cardiomyopathy. This is a kind of cardiomyopathy. So we did a MRI strain on the grid. So these are the features I was telling you. Truncated and spherical LV apex, rightward bulging of the interventricular septum, elongated RV wrapping around deficient LV apex, replacement of LV apical myocardium, distal IVS with fibrofatty material, epicardial fat, anomalous origin of anterior LV pap movements, systolic dysfunction, diastolic dysfunction, one of them or both of them. They may have heart failure, permanent edema, ventricular arrhythmia, rarely something. Obviously, LV syndrome. So, this is the reversible constriction patient. Subacute effusive constrictive pericarditis. This is a CT. You can see the pericardial thickening. Demonstrating pericardial thickening, you have to describe how much thick, what are the areas of thickness, where is it normal, where is it abnormal, calcium present or absent, whether this thickened pericardium is going into myocardium. That is a very dangerous sign. When the thickened myocardium and calcium is burrowing into myocardium, then the pericardectomy is going to be tough. Surgeon may tear the myocardium or carotids. Postoperative residual constriction will be there. They don't do too bad.
What is the normal thickness of the pericardium?
2 mm.
2 mm. 2 mm. Let me describe that 2 mm.
The same patients constructive perturbations, reversible constructive perturbations. So I am showing you gadolinium enhancement, that is the reason why
it is.
Better immune. Yeah, you can see. There is a gadolinium enhancement of the pericardium, which means there is acute inflammation, which means potentially reversible. Recently, a month back, I saw an MLA's wife, she was 43 years. She had, I don't want to do the full story, but the long story. She had a pericardial effusion diagnosed, and then somebody in some hospital, they did a cath in Hyderabad. They found diastolic equivalent lesion. They made a diagnosis of constrictive pericardial, sent to the surgeon. Then surgeon posted for surgery 3 days later. Meanwhile, somebody asked her to see me. She came. Then we investigated and found there was an acute inflammatory pericardium. And when I examined, there was no evidence of constriction to the brain. I told her, don't be in a hurry. It is resolving, so nothing like that. Then after 3 weeks, she came back, everything was normal. But on CAT, all hemodynamic abnormalities described were there of constriction.
What can happen usually, you really require cardiac care to make a diagnosis of constriction? What are the conditions that need to require? Are you around with the total exactly diagnosis? As things stand today, it's only
more dynamic
diagnosis.
And you get around the information, more dynamic information on the record. Inflammation or no inflammation, you get on either PET or MR.
If you read the textbook of biology by Hurst, where the factor is written by Sarkaran, they get by definition. According to their protocol in Mayo Clinic, all patients with pericarditis, even if they recover clinically, they undergo MR. To see persisting inflammation or no inflammation. There is persisting inflammation, then they have one group of pharmacotherapy. If there is no persistent inflammation, no other group of pharmacotherapy. So there, but I don't think we can afford to do that in all pericarditis undergoing MRI for inflammation.
The all patients with pericardial effusion, you must look the neighborhood.
Yeah.
There may be esophageal pathology, mediastinal pathology, lung pathology. So CT is a must. The MRI cannot show the lung. Okay? MRI or PET CT must to know whether it is acute inflammation or not. To make a decision. Decision is very important. The reason being, pericarditomy in chronic constrictive pericarditis has a higher surgical risk than even CABG or valve.
One of the highest surgical risks is pericarditis.
10%. Best hospital, best surgeon, the risk is 10%. Your CABG risk is 2%. Okay. So, look at this. You see that gadolinium enhancement. Very nice to see. That's it. A few more, but I mean, not already three, almost.
Almost. 2.5 hours.
When are we meeting the echo?
Echo is on Friday.
But now I don't know, they're able not to pay. We can.
No. I will make arrangement for it to be.
Videos, because that will be full of.
Yeah. I will make sure that videos can come.
Now we manage. Yeah.